Hello, welcome to my very first art tutorial. I put together a little time lapse of me creating this artwork that you see. So I thought it'd be fun to just record a little commentary, talk about my art process and all that stuff. So let's jump in. I did the sketch already in Photoshop. And I'm going to be inking in Photoshop as well. The first time I tried to ink digitally, I didn't like it. My style was different back then. It was a little more illustrative, a little more traditional comic book style, lots of thick brush lines, very inky, very loose. And at the time, I don't think that Photoshop could really capture what I wanted in the inks. As well as traditional inks with like a brush and just a bottle of ink. But as my sort of style evolved and I took more influence from my background in graphic design, I started looking for something that was a little bit more precise, I guess is the best word. More precise, more graphic, kind of rigid in a way, almost looks like a vector art. So Photoshop is really the best way for me to achieve that look. There's also some sort of features and brush settings that they've added since the first time I tried to ink digitally that have helped out a lot, particularly the brush smoothing. So the brush smoothing does, I guess, exactly what it sounds like. It smooths out your lines, but more than that, I like it because it gives you kind of a feeling of resistance. It feels a little bit more like drawing on paper. Sometimes when you're drawing on a tablet, you know, the tip of your stylus is plastic, the tablet screen is plastic, and it's very slick. And I think before when you're inked in Photoshop, it just, there was something about the lines that just felt too fast. They kind of lacked the resistance, the grit of the paper that you'd feel when you were drawing. So putting on that brush smoothing really helps with that. And like I said, I'm going for a pretty precise look, so having it just kind of smooth out those lines a little bit is also really helpful. Probably my favorite thing about inking digitally, the biggest advantage to me, is being able to sort of draw through areas or past areas where you don't want the line. And what I mean by that is, you know, if you're inking traditionally, you just have the ink. And if you make a mistake, you either leave the mistake and just live with it, or you white it out or something like that, or try to fix it in Photoshop or something like that. But, you know, so you're drawing and you have to, say, make a line from point A to point B. You can't really start before point A, and you can't have the line continue past point B. And a lot of times when you see artists where their pencils are really fluid and nice, and then you see their inks and they're kind of stiff and restricted, it's because they just, it's hard to get that sort of flow and that follow through in your lines when you have to a firm beginning and end point. So inking in digitally is really nice because you can just put each line on a new layer if you want and sort of ink past the area that you want, and then kind of clean it up with the eraser. And that's really just, it really helps give the lines a nice kind of fluid curve to them. Another really nice thing is being able to manipulate the lines and use shape layers, like you'll see I'm doing here with the eyes. Rather than trying to draw perfect circles, I just use the shape tool, set to a line thickness that's similar to the brush that I use. And then I can just, you know, rasterize the shapes and erase the bits that I don't need. You'll see me here in a bit drawing, you know, just past the line that I need, even though I know I'm going to erase it there, just to get that fluid motion. I try to do lines, as many of them, in one sort of stroke. I don't like to stop in the middle of a line unless I really have to. Sometimes it's hard to get like the top of the head or like really long hair or something in one stroke and get it exactly how I want it to be, and I'll have to sort of break it into two, but I try to make every line one kind of fluid stroke. And, you know, I don't know how much of that is, like, communicated, but it feels like it makes a difference to me. It's also nice when you're drawing something that's supposed to be symmetrical to be inking digitally, because you can just sort of copy and paste and transform it, you know, so you know that one side matches the other side. A lot of times I'll actually, I'll do that, but then I'll change one side a little bit, so I'll copy one side of somebody's face, you know, flip it around and put it on the other side, but I'll make little small changes just so it's not exactly the same. Just makes it look a little bit more natural. Those little blue dots, those tones that are in my sketch, are just a halftone brush. I think it was the one that was made by Kyle Webster, who does a lot of Photoshop brushes. He's an illustrator and designer. But I use those in my final artwork as well. The reason they're in my sketch is I want to block in where my shadows are. I do all my shadows with color. I don't spot blacks, meaning I don't, like, fill in the shadow areas with, like, you know, ink, or digital ink in this case, which is in some ways a little bit less dynamic, but I think I'm always surprised how much volume you can get just by using color, you know, darker color to block in the shadows instead of black ink. I think a lot of my style has evolved out of a desire to kind of see how few lines I can make and still make an illustration look like a particular person or character, or communicate what it needs to communicate. You know, it's not simplified to the point of, like, say, like, emojis or something like that, but I like to see if I can just sort of use a few simple lines to capture somebody's likeness. So by not spotting blacks, it kind of just helps me use less lines. So the inking is almost done here. It looks like I'm just filling in some of these plants, the mango tree leaves in the background. So after I finish inking, I actually vectorize my line art, which I don't know if is a thing that I've heard of other people doing, really. And by that, I mean I take the raster graphics, the brush lines that I make for my inks, and I'll copy them and paste them into Illustrator. And then I use a feature in Illustrator called Image Trace. And what that'll do is take my black and white lines and turn them into vector graphics, which is kind of neat because after they're vector, you can blow them up to any size and they'll retain the same thickness and things like that. But more the reason I do it is just it gives the lines, like, a certain quality. When you use Image Trace, it'll take that raster art, and Illustrator will basically try to turn that raster graphic into, like, a series of vector points. So it has to kind of make up details, and it kind of makes the lines look like they're almost, like, globbing together where they meet. And for me, it has the look of something that's printed on newsprint, like an old comic book, you know, almost like the ink is bleeding a little bit. And it's probably one of those things that most people don't notice, but it just thickens the lines up and kind of, you know, blurs them at the edges. And I just really like the way it looks. It makes it a little bit harder to edit things. And it's, you know, probably an extra step that I don't really need, but I think it's those little kind of small touches that kind of make up, you know, your personal style as an artist. Not to sound too highfalutin about my own art, but it's just those little things, those little techniques that you develop in your personal tastes that make something unique. So the first step in my coloring process is something called flatting, which is a little bit weird to explain, but essentially you put a layer underneath your line art fill it all with one color and then select everything. And then with the lasso tool, you start deselecting stuff and then filling what's left with a different color. And it's really just a process of breaking up a layer underneath your line art into selections. So it's not really a creative process. You're just sort of mechanically creating this reference layer that has all the selections you need. So when I start actually choosing the colors I want to use, I just kind of create a new layer on top of that, and then I can use my flats to select every single area on it, you know? So if I just need to select the lips, I can grab the lips with my magic wand from my flats layer and then fill it with whatever color I want on a layer above that. And it's just good for keeping everything very editable and customizable. You know, if I do a version of the colors and I'm getting towards the end of it and the color palette's just not quite right, I can just sort of, I still have those selections, so I can just do a new one. It also helps if you need to edit something. Maybe you're doing client work and they're like, oh, this person's hair needs to be yellow, not orange. And so you can just grab, you already have a selection for all that hair and you can just change it however you need it. And then honestly, part of the reason I do this is just because this is how I learned how to do it when I was first figuring out how to use Photoshop. You know, when I first got interested in Photoshop, it was through the lens of comic book art. So I learned everything sort of how comic book artists do it and what that process is. And comic book colorists typically start by flatting everything. Or they pay somebody else to flat everything for them. Because like I said, it's not creative. It's just sort of breaking up the art into the layers and the selections that you need. Some people don't like it because it's very tedious. I actually like the process a lot because at this point in the drawing, a lot of the hard work is done. And it's just, you just have to execute it at this point. So, I don't know, it's kind of fun. I like to put on some really loud music when I'm flatting and just sort of, you know, get lost in it. And I will also, you know, not just like selecting, like it's not like I'll just have the skin as one selection. I also put the shadows that would be on the skin as their own selection, which you could see I'm doing here. Which is why it's helpful to have those halftones already made in my sketch so I know where all my shadows and highlights are. So the flatting is almost done. You can see I'm trying to make one more selection for Sean Connery's chest hair there. And this is really my favorite part of the process because now really all the work is done and I just need to choose colors. So this is kind of nice because you can really start to see the, you know, it looks almost unfinished. You've just got line art, but once you have the selections are done, you just need to choose your colors and drop them in. I mean, the rest of this part takes maybe 20 minutes and the drawing really comes together quickly. Or if it doesn't come together, then you know you probably have a serious problem and then it's frustrating. But most of the time, you know, you've worked out any potential problems. So I fill in my shadows with halftone brushes. I'll start like you see here by just putting down kind of a base color. So if you take Sean Connery's skin, for example, you know, I found a good sort of base kind of flesh tone that I liked for Sean Connery. And then what I'll do is grab the selection of kind of all of his skin. And I'll usually put down a white halftone, just a series with the halftone brushes. So there's just kind of a layer of like white dots above him, above his skin. And I'll lighten that up a little bit. And then I'll grab the selection that I have in my flats for the shadow, and I'll use like dark red or dark brown or something like that, and fill in the shadows with that same halftone brush and kind of mess with the opacity depending on how much contrast I want between the shadow and the base skin layer. And just kind of with those two little layers of halftones, you can get quite a bit of contrast and volume. And there's something about it, I don't know, it just has a retro comic book kind of feel that I really like. And it looks really good once you put texture on top of it. I use a lot of textures in my art. I actually mainly use kind of the same group of textures. I have about 10 different textures, some that I created, some that I got off the internet, you know, paper textures, photocopy textures, things like that. And I just, they're all set to different opacities, different blending modes, and I just keep those in a layer group. And so whenever I start a new project, I just copy that layer group from a previous project, paste it in there, and resize it if I need to, and just kind of keep using those same bits. So you can see here now I have the texture layer turned on, and it looks really nice with those halftones. At this point, it's really just a matter of putting in some finishing touches. You can see here I'm trying to figure out how I want to do Sean Connery's chest hair. I think I just ended up adding some kind of slightly bigger halftone dots that were like dark brown or something like that. That's about it for this video. I'm hoping to do more process videos in the future, or maybe even do like tutorials. So just leave me a comment and let me know what you'd like to see. That's it. Thanks for watching. Bye.